Good morning, students. Today I am going to give introduction to a new chapter, namely current electricity. First, we are going to understand how electric current flows through the metals. So the topic of discussion is conduction in metals. Now, if you consider a metallic conductor like copper or aluminium, the atoms inside the conductor are very tightly and very closely packed. As a result, all the atoms come very closer to each other, such that the outermost electrons revolving around the nucleus of every atom will enter into the region of the neighboring atoms. As a result, these valence electrons particularly will be called as free electrons. And these free electrons will be moving from one place to another place, from one point to another point inside the conductor. So you can see the first picture. This is a metallic conductor XY, and inside the conductor, these free electrons, namely the outermost electrons, they are moving in different directions. So whenever these negatively charged electrons are moving from one place to another place, or from one point to another point within the same conductor, they constitute an electric current. But they are moving in random directions. As a result, the current produced by all these electrons are in different directions. If you add the currents produced by all these electrons, then the net current will be equal to zero. And there is no net current flowing through the conductor XY. Okay. What can we do to make all the electrons to flow in a single direction? So for that, we have to connect a battery across the conductor. In the second picture, you can see that the end X is connected to the positive of a battery, and the end Y is connected to the negative terminal of a battery, so that now a potential difference of V volt is applied across the conductor XY. So the end X is having a positive potential and the end Y is having a negative potential. If you divide this potential difference between the conductor XY by the length of the conductor, that will be equal to the electric field. So in the second picture, you can see that an electric field is established across the conductor. So under the influence of the electric field, now the free electrons will be moving towards the positive end of the electric field. So you can see that the end X is positive now, and all the negatively charged electrons will be moving towards the positive potential of the electric field. So this will be the picture. Okay, all these electrons now move in a single direction. As a result, a current will be established in the conductor. So this is the atomic picture of every metallic conductor, inside which the flow of electrons, the flow of electric charges takes place. So this only is called as electric current. So in general, how do we define electric current? In the earlier classes also we have studied, no? Electric current is defined as the rate of flow of electric charges. So what is meant by electric current we have defined? Electric current, it is defined as the rate of flow of electric charges. Rate of flow of electric charges. Now, what type of charges are flowing through a metallic conductor? They are the electrons. Electrons are responsible for the flow of current through the conductors. Now, this quantity of electric charges are always represented with a symbol Q. Okay. Sometimes what will happen? Equal quantities of charges will pass through the cross section of the conductor in equal intervals of time. Then in such a situation, the electric current is called steady current. Steady current. This steady current is denoted by the symbol C. Steady current is denoted by I is equal to Q by T, where Q is the steady flow of charges. So equal intervals of time is denoted by T and equal quantities of charges is denoted by Q and this Q by T is equal to I is called the steady current. And the unit of Q is Coulomb and unit of T is second. So this is Coulomb per second. Coulomb per second. This is also called as ampere. The unit of electric current is what? Either coulomb per second or ampere. So when 1 coulomb of charge will cross the cross section of the conductor during 1 second of time, then the current is said to be 1 ampere. So 1 ampere is also equal to what? 1 coulomb per second. Sometimes what will happen? Unequal quantity of charges will flow through the conductor in equal intervals of time. In such a case, the current is not steady. It is called as what? Unsteady current. Okay? Unsteady current. So, what do you mean by unsteady current? When is the flow of current said to be unsteady? Here, unequal. Okay? Quantity of charges. Unequal. Quantity of a charge or charges flowing in equal or flow in equal intervals of time. Equal intervals of time. So this unsteady current is denoted by what? I is equal to limit delta t tending to 0. This is a delta q divided by delta t. So, how much quantity of charge is flowing divided by the proportionate the interval of time. This also can be written as what? dq by dt. So, this also is equal to what? dq by dt. So, I is equal to dq by dt. So, the steady current. Now, steady current can be graphically represented. So, if you draw a graph for the steady current, I versus T. So this is the time T and this is the current I. For a steady current, okay, for a steady current, if you take means, it will be a graph having a straight line parallel to the time axis. So even from the beginning up to the end as the time is proceeding, the current will be the same, okay. It is a steady current, means constant current is flowing, okay. And if you draw a graph for unsteady current, means unsteady current can be represented by any graph like this, okay. So the current is continuously increasing with the time. Current is continuously increasing with time, or the current may be continuously decreasing with the time, or the current may be alternating like this. So this is current is changing with the time, okay. So this type of current is called as what? Unsteady current. So in general, whether it is steady current or unsteady current, current means it is depend as the rate of flow of electric charges. And if equal quantities of charges are flowing in equal intervals of time, then the current is said to be steady current. That means a constant current. So that the current versus the time graph will be a straight line parallel to the x-axis or the time axis. When unequal quantity of charges are flowing across the cross section in equal intervals of time, then the current is said to be unsteady. So if the current is steady, means it is represented by the equation I equal to Q by T, and if the current is unsteady, means it is represented by the expression I equal to limit delta T tending to 0 delta Q by delta T, or I is equal to dq by dt. In both the cases, what is the SI unit of current? It is ampere. And 1 ampere is also equal to 1 coulomb per second, or the current is said to be 1 ampere when the flow of charges take place in a conductor at a rate of 1 coulomb per second. Okay students, have you all understood electric current? Shall we go to the next topic, Ohm's law? Okay. Now we will see Ohm's law. The statement of Ohm's law, let us see first. At constant temperature, the potential difference across a conductor is proportional to the current flowing through the conductor. That means the symbol for potential difference is V and the symbol for current is I. So according to the statement of Ohm's law, V is proportional to I at constant temperature. Now look at this diagram. This is a cross section of a metallic conductor, and it is having a length equal to L. XY is a metallic conductor whose length is L. The end X is connected to the positive of a battery, so it is having a positive potential, and the end Y is connected to the negative of a battery, and hence it is having a negative potential. Therefore, there is a potential difference existing between the ends X and Y, and the potential difference is denoted by what, a capital V. Okay. Now, because of the applying of potential difference across the conductor, how do the free electrons flow? They are all flowing from the negative potential towards the positive potential. That is against the opposite to the direction of the electric field. So these electrons constitute a current which is called as electron current. But right since the invention of electric current by conventional method, it was assumed that positive charges only are flowing through a conductor. So by conventions, if you see, the flow of positive charges must take place from the positive potential towards the negative potential. And such a flow of positive charges is called as what, conventional current. So here two types of current we have come across. One is the electron current. The electron current is due to the flow of negatively charged electrons from the lower potential to the higher potential in a direction opposite to that of the electric field. And the conventional current is represented by the symbol capital I. Okay, usually the conventional current is represented by the symbol capital I in any circuit. Okay, and this is the current which is due to the flow of positive charges from the positive potential towards the negative potential. Anyhow, the statement is the potential difference is directly proportional to I. Therefore, we can write V is equal to a constant of proportionality R into I, where this constant of proportionality is called as the electrical resistance of the conductor. The electrical resistance of the conductor, okay, of the conductor. So from this expression V equal to R into I, let us try to get an expression for the electrical resistance R. So what is R equal to? V divided by I. So this is the expression for the electrical resistance. So how to define electrical resistance from this expression? The electrical resistance of a conductor is defined as the ratio of the potential difference applied across the conductor to the current flowing through the conductor. So its unit must be equal to what, volt per ampere. But the standard unit for electrical resistance is what? Ohm. Ohm is the standard unit for resistance. Okay. So the reciprocal of the electrical resistance, 1 by R, reciprocal of the electrical resistance is denoted by the symbol capital G, and this is called as a conductance. Okay. Conductance. The conductance is having a unit. So its unit of conductance is equal to what, 1 by ohm, and that is equal to mho mho. Okay, because the unit of resistance is ohm, the reciprocal of ohm must be the unit for the conductance, and that is denoted as mho. And again, ohm is having a symbol like a hat. So this is the symbol used to express the unit of ohm, and hence this mho must be ohm power minus 1. Okay, mho is nothing but ohm power minus 1. So resistance is defined as the ratio of the potential difference across the two ends of the conductor to the current flowing through the conductor, and its SI unit is ohm. And the reciprocal of the electrical resistance is called as the conductance, and it's having a unit equal to the reciprocal of ohm. 1 by ohm is also called as mho, or ohm power minus 1. Okay, now there are some factors on which the resistance of a wire or conductor depends upon. So that is the next topic we are going to study, the factors influencing, okay, the factors influencing R, okay, factors influencing resistance of conductor. Resistance of a conductor. So what are the factors on which the resistance of a conductor depends upon? Now for that, let us consider two conductors. Okay, one conductor is made up of copper whose length is 1 meter. For example, this is 1 meter, and another conductor of the same thickness and area of cross section, but it is having a length of 2 meters. So this is conductor 1 and this is conductor 2. In both these conductors, they do not have the same electrical resistance. Though they are made up of the same material and though they are having the same thickness and area of cross section, what is differing from each other? It is the length. So how does the current flow through these conductors? We have seen in the earlier picture, it is due to the flow of free electrons from one end to the other end. And on the way, these free electrons will have frequent and random collisions with the ions of the crystal or ions of the conducting wire. As a result, their flow will be obstructed to some extent. So this obstruction to the flow of the passage of electrons only is called as electrical resistance. So this electrical resistance is nothing but the opposition offered by the positive ions which are present inside the conductor during the collision of these free electrons. In this picture, we have shown only the flow of free electrons. Other than free electrons, every atom is having a positively charged nucleus also, is it not? So they are all ions. These ions will be vibrating in the path of these electrons, and there will be frequent collision of these free electrons with these ions. This only is a measurement of what the opposition offered to the flow of free electrons, and it is called as electrical resistance. So naturally, if the length of the path is very small or short, very less collisions only the free electrons must have encountered. And if the length of the path is very large, then more number of collisions should have taken place. This is the simple example I can compare is number of speed breakers in a road. If the road length is less, only a very few number of speed breakers the automobiles will come across. Suppose if you take a very long distance and many number of speed breakers must have been there, means then the opposition to the speed also will be more. In a simple context, now I can say that the resistance of a conductor R is directly proportional to the length. So this is very, very important factor. So what is the first factor on which the electrical resistance of a conductor depends? It is the length of the conductor. And how does it depend? The resistance is directly proportional to the length. Okay. Now, next case, let us take another wire which is having a length of 1 meter. So this is having a length of 1 meter and another wire which is very thick. Okay, very thick. This also is having a length of 1 meter. In the second case, I have considered two conductors having the equal length. But what is different? The area of cross section is different. Okay. Now, in which of these two cases more number of electrons can cross the cross section every second? You see here, this is like a pipe conveying water. And this is a very large pipe conveying more water. Therefore, here the number of electrons crossing every cross section will be very less. Whereas here, at the same time, here more number of electrons can come out through this cross section. So in a given time, in which of these two wires more number of electrons can be conducted easily is the second case, is it not? So if the cross section of the wire is very large, means more number of electrons can cross at a time. That means conduction is more, conductivity is more. Therefore, the resistance should be less. So if the area of cross section is large, then the electrical resistance will be less. Understand? Therefore, how does the resistance of the conductor depend on the area of cross section? Directly or inversely? Yes, it is inversely proportional to the area of cross section. So I can take that R is proportional to 1 by A, where A is called the area of cross section of the conductor. So now, what are the two factors on which the resistance of a conductor depends? One is its length, and the second one is its area of cross section. How does it depend on? The radius of the resistance of the conductor is directly proportional to its length, and the resistance of the conductor is inversely proportional to its area of cross section. Combining these two, I am going to write R is proportional to L by A. R is proportional to L by A. Or we can also write this as an equation by multiplying by a constant of proportionality, and that one is rho into L by A. So this is a standard equation for solving numerical problems in competitive exams. So the resistance of a conductor is equal to rho, a constant of proportionality, into length L divided by area of cross section A. And this rho, I told it is a constant of proportionality, which is called as the resistivity or specific resistance. It is having two names. What are the two names? Rho is called the resistivity or specific resistance of whom? Of the material of the conductor. Of the material. Okay, material means what? It may be copper or aluminium, with which the wire or conductor is made up of. So it is a property of the material with which the conductor is made up of. So if I will write an expression for the specific resistance, rho, means rearrange this and we get an expression for rho equal to what? R into A divided by L. So R into A divided by L. The unit of resistance R is ohm, and the unit of area is meter square, divided by the unit of length is meter. So this square and this term get cancelled. What is remaining? So what is the unit? Unit of rho is ohm into meter. Isn't that? Ohm into meter is the unit of what? Specific resistance or resistivity. Understand? Okay, now how to define this specific resistance? We will get a definition for the specific resistance by taking, if length is equal to 1 meter and area of cross section is equal to 1 meter square. Imagine a wire is having a length of 1 meter and area of cross section is 1 meter square. Then what will be rho equal to? If you substitute, then rho is equal to what? R into 1 divided by 1. This is equal to R itself. Is it not? So when the area of cross section is 1 meter square and the length of the wire is 1 meter, then what will be the resistance offered by the material? That is equal to its resistivity. So how to define resistivity or specific resistance? The specific resistance of a material is defined as the resistance offered by a conductor having unit length and unit area of cross section. Understand? And what is its unit? Specific resistance is having a unit of ohm meter. Okay. Now I will take the reciprocal of the resistivity, 1 by rho. This is denoted by the symbol sigma. 1 by rho, this is the reciprocal of the resistivity, and it is denoted by the symbol sigma, and this is called as conductivity. This is called as conductivity of the material. Okay, conductivity is defined as what? The reciprocal of the resistivity of the material. And if the unit of resistivity is ohm meter, means then unit of sigma must be equal to 1 divided by ohm meter, and this is equal to ohm power minus 1 meter power minus 1, and this also is called as mho per meter. Okay students, let us summarize. Now what we have studied here is the statement of Ohm's law. At constant temperature, The potential difference across a conductor is proportional to the current flowing through the conductor. That is, V is proportional to I, or V is equal to a constant of proportionality R into I. And from this expression, the resistance of the conductor R is found to be equal to the ratio of the potential difference of the current flowing through the conductor, and its SI unit is ohm. And the reciprocal of the electrical resistance is called as the conductance G, and its SI unit is what? Ohm power minus 1. Okay. Now, what are the different factors on which the resistance of the conductor actually depends on? It is depending on the length, that is directly. R is proportional to L and inversely proportional to the area of cross section. And combining these two, we have got R is equal to rho into L by A. From this equation, you must know that the resistance of the conductor depends upon three factors. In this equation, there are three factors. What are the factors? The resistance depends upon the length of the conductor, area of cross section of the conductor, and the material of the conductor. In addition to this, what will happen if the conductor is heated? When the conductor is heated, the electrons will absorb the heat energy and they will vibrate vigorously. Their kinetic energy will be increased. Also, the ions will vibrate vigorously so that the electrical resistance will change. Understand? Because when the ions will obstruct the path by vibrating vigorously, then more resistance will be given to the free electrons. So, as the temperature increases, the resistance will also change. This is why we have started Ohm's law. How? At constant temperature only, this is true. Okay, students, in this equation, there are three factors. That is, resistance depends upon the length of the conductor, area of cross section, and the specific resistance of the material. In addition to that, it also depends on the temperature. That later we are going to study. Okay, students. So, from this, what is the expression for the specific resistance? We have got rho equal to R into A by L. Substituting the units individually, what is the final unit of rho equal to ohm meter? Ohm into meter. Okay, if length of the conductor is specified as 1 meter and area of cross section is specified as 1 meter square, then what should be rho equal to R? This is how we have got a definition for specific resistance. So, the resistivity or specific resistance of the material of a conductor is defined as the resistance offered to the flow of current by a conductor of length 1 meter and area of cross section 1 meter square. Finally, what is the reciprocal of the resistivity? It is called as conductivity. So, what must be the unit of conductivity then? 1 by ohm meter. That is the ohm inverse per meter. That ohm inverse also is called as mho. Therefore, sigma is having a unit of what? Mho per meter. Okay, students, so next we are going to see the microscopic form of Ohm's law, which is very interesting. Okay. Microscopic form of Ohm's law. Previously, what we have derived was a macroscopic form of Ohm's law. So, what is the expression for the macroscopic form of Ohm's law we have derived already? V is equal to I into R. So, this is called the macroscopic form of Ohm's law. Now, look at the conductor once again given in the picture. XY is a conductor whose length is L. And the end X is connected to the positive of a battery. So, it is at a positive potential. The end Y is connected to the negative of a battery, and hence it is at a negative potential. So, V is the potential difference between the two ends of the conductor. As a result, the free electrons will be attracted towards the positive potential, and there is an electric field E established across the conductor XY, and that electric field E is equal to the potential gradient V by L. Okay. And the conventional current is due to the flow of positive charges, and this is equal and opposite to that of the electrons. So, this must be the direction of the conventional current I, and this must be the direction of the electric field from the positive towards the negative potential. Okay. So, from this expression for Ohm's law, V is equal to I into R. But In terms of the specific resistance, what is the resistance of a conductor equal to? The resistance of a conductor is rho into L by A, where A is the area of cross section. So this area of cross section of the conductor is taken as A. So R is equal to rho into L by A. I am going to substitute here. Therefore, now what will be V equal to? V is equal to I into rho L by A. This I will readjust again. This is also equal to, that is V is equal to I divided by A into rho into L. And this is equation 1. I have just distributed the terms in a different pattern, so that the first one is I by A multiplied by rho into L. This I by A is called as the current flowing through unit area, current per unit area. So this I by A is equal to current flowing per unit area. This current per unit area is denoted by the symbol J, and this J is called as current density. Current density. Now current by itself is a scalar quantity only, but current per unit area is a vector quantity. Therefore this J is called a vector quantity. So I can also represent this by vector symbol, and this J vector is called by what name? It is current density, and its direction is along the direction of the electric field. The current density J and the electric field both are along the same direction, along the direction of the conventional current, and opposite to the direction of the flow of the free electrons. Okay, so in equation 1, now V equal to I by A into rho L. Instead of I by A, I can substitute the magnitude of current density. Therefore, now V is equal to J into rho into L. And this is equation 2. I have substituted only the magnitude of the current density. Okay, if E is the electric field, V is the potential difference, and L is the length of the conductor, then what is electric field? E is equal to V by L, or what is V? Is E also equal to E into L? Is it not? So from the definition of this electric field, the potential difference V is also equal to what? E into L. So look at the equations 2 and 3. I am going to compare these two equations. So comparing equations 2 and 3, or from equations 2 and 3, okay, see, J into rho into L, this is equal to E into L. So the length L is getting cancelled on both sides. Therefore, what is J is equal to E divided by rho. This is one of the steps in our main equation. So this is J equal to E by rho. So this also can be written as, E multiplied by 1 by rho. But 1 by rho is also equal to what? It is the reciprocal of resistivity, which is called as what? Conductivity. Is it not? See here, 1 by rho. So this is also equal to what? E multiplied by what? Sigma. Where sigma is equal to 1 by rho is called as what? Yes, the conductivity. Therefore, finally we can write that in vector form, J vector is equal to E vector into sigma. So J vector is equal to sigma times E vector. This only is called as what? Microscopic form of Ohm's law. What is the macroscopic form of Ohm's law? V is equal to I into R. Okay, V is equal to I into R. And what is the microscopic form of Ohm's law? J vector is equal to sigma times E vector. So J vector and E vector both are along the same direction. Understand? Okay, now the graphical representation of Ohm's law. Generally, we draw the graph between the potential difference and the current. So it is the choice of the person who takes the voltage along the x-axis or y-axis. Similarly, current also can be chosen either along the x-axis or the y-axis. Now, what will be the graph? If you draw a graph between the voltage taken along the x-axis and the current taken along the y-axis. Now, first one is for metals, okay, for metals, for metallic conductors like copper and aluminium and all. If you draw a graph between voltage and the current means, then you, the nature of the graph will be a straight line passing through the origin, okay? And on this graph, if you take any two points and project these points, on the x and y axis respectively. So let us take, this is a first one, second, the third and the fourth. I have taken the second point and the fourth point and projected along the x axis, that is voltage axis. So this difference is denoted by delta V. Similarly, this difference along the y axis is denoted by delta I. And the slope of this graph is always the y intercept divided by the x intercept, and that is equal to y intercept is what, delta I divided by delta V. Now the reciprocal of the slope, that is 1 by slope, is equal to delta V divided by delta I, and this will be equal to R, that is equal to the resistance of the conductor. So what is the significance of this graphical representation? From this graph you have to find out the slope, and the slope is equal to what, the reciprocal of the resistance, or the reciprocal of the slope is equal to what, R, and that is equal to what, the resistance, electrical resistance of the wire, or resistance of the conductor. Okay students, so we have studied Ohm's law today in macroscopic form, that is V equal to IR, as well as the microscopic form, that is what, J vector is equal to sigma times E vector. And from the graphical representation between voltage and current, we can find the slope. Now you can see that the nature of the graph is a straight line, it is linear graph. And such device which obeys Ohm's law is called as a ohmic device or linear device. Okay, any device which obeys Ohm's law is called a ohmic device. And also, if the straight line graph is available between V and I, means then it's a linear graph. Therefore, the device itself is called a linear device. Suppose if the graph is not a straight line, then that device does not obey Ohm's law. Such a device which does not obey Ohm's law is called as what, a non-ohmic device. Non-ohmic device. And the graph will not be a straight line, it will be curved line. And we are going to study in detail in the further topics also. As an introduction, I am telling you that if the graph is not a straight line, that is also called as a non-linear device. Okay, it is also called as what, a non-linear device. And for examples, diodes, semiconductors, diodes, transistors, these are all some of the semiconductor devices for which if you draw the graph between voltage and current, it will not be a straight line. So ohmic device is any device which obeys Ohm's law, and the voltage current graph will be a straight line passing through the origin. And non-ohmic device is any device which does not obey Ohm's law, and for that the graph will not be a straight line, and hence that device is also called as a non-linear device. So we are going to end up with this topic. Next topic is drift velocity and the relation between current and drift velocity. Okay, then see you.